Good morning. Welcome to our worship service this morning. A special warm welcome to any guests that we have with us. Good to have you here. We're continuing our celebration of the Easter season that our Savior, who died, is living and living for us and giving us everything that we need so that we can be sure of our life here and in eternity. And that's the kind of the special focus we get to have specifically today as we consider this theme. It's good to be Jesus' sheep. Today is Good Shepherd Sunday. We celebrate that Sunday every year, and we get to consider how Jesus cares for us and how we are confident in entrusting ourselves to him with all of our needs and cares. So we'll worship according to that theme this morning, and we're going to begin with our opening hymn, My Shepherd Will Supply My Need. Everything will be printed for you up on the screens. May God bless our worship. Please stand. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and his Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. We have come into the presence of God who created us to love and serve him as his dear children. But we have disobeyed him and deserve only his wrath and punishment. Therefore, let us confess our sins to him and plead for his mercy. Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from birth.
In countless ways I have sinned against you and do not deserve to be called your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sin and take away my guilt.
God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all your sins. By the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ, he has removed your guilt forever. You are his own dear child. May God give you strength to live according to his will. Amen. In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord. O Lord Jesus Christ, you are the good shepherd who laid down your life for the sheep. Lead us now to the still waters of your life-giving word, that we may abide in your Father's house forevermore. For you live and reign with him and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Our first lesson for this morning comes to us from the book of Acts, chapter 4, verses 23 through 33, where we hear about how the apostles who had been arrested, they are released from prison, and they gather again with their fellow believers and pray to God, pray that he would use his almighty power to overthrow all the plans of those who are opposing them and the message that God has given them to preach. And they're given some assurance by a miraculous shaking of the place where they're staying so that they are filled with confidence in the Holy Spirit to go and preach. We have that same confidence that God is with us and protects us as we live our Christian lives as his sheep in this world. On their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. When they heard this, they raised their voices together in prayer to God. Sovereign Lord, they said, you made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them. You spoke by the Holy Spirit through the mouth of your servant, our father David. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth rise up and the rulers band together against the Lord and against his anointed one. Indeed, Herod and Pontius Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in this city to conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and will had decided beforehand should happen. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal and perform signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. After they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. All the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all. This is the word of our Lord. We continue with an anthem by the choir, Psalm 23. At this time, I'd invite all the children to come forward to hear the children's message. Good morning. Welcome, welcome. Brought a little friend today. We'll call him Ralph. He's not creepy. He's a little stuffed animal. Hey, what kind of animal is this? A dog, right? Any of you have pets at home? Have a dog, maybe? Maybe a cat? Goldfish? I saw a goldfish a couple weeks ago, right, with Pastor Freeman. Okay, so when you have a pet, what do you have to do for that pet, Harley? You have to take care of it, right? How do you take care of a pet? Okay, food and water, right? You got to put out a bowl, maybe if you have a dog, put out a bowl of food, put out a bowl of water every day, maybe twice a day so that they can eat and drink, right? What else do you have to do? Take care of a pet. You just feed it and that's it? Madison. You have to play with it, right? Yeah. You gotta play with your pet. That's maybe more for the kids sometimes than the animal. But yeah, they need exercise, right? So whether you let them run around, it depends on the kind of pet, right? But you gotta make sure they're getting the exercise they need, okay? So maybe you take your dog on a walk, something like that, right? Anything else you do to take care of a pet? Tatum. What do you think? Carly? Okay, yeah, he's got to go potty, right? Yep, got to take him outside to do that. Yep. Maybe if you have a cat, you've got a litter box, right? So they can do that. What about at nighttime? Anything special you maybe do for a pet at nighttime? Yeah, you got a little bed for it, right? Maybe there's a kennel for the dog to go in, or just maybe a nice little area with a blanket where they can sleep. So all different ways that you take care of your pets, right? Well, today we're talking about a different kind of a thing, but there's some similarities. We're talking about how we are sheep of Jesus, and Jesus takes care of us. In some ways, like we take care of a pet, yeah? Jesus, what does he do to take care of us? Carly. He gives us food, right? And water, yeah? He gives us a place to stay, right? A home. He gives us parents and friends and family, yeah? Something else? He gives us a bed, right? So Jesus provides everything that we need, too. And not only for this life, right? He provides everything that we need, even for eternal life. Or that time when we'll get to be with him in heaven. How does he provide for us for that? How does he give us everything we need so that we can be in heaven? What did he do for us so we could be in heaven? Probably. Yeah. He took away our sins by dying on the cross. It's the ultimate way of taking care of us, huh? And even cooler, he didn't stay dead, right? He rose back from the dead, and now he lives for us, and he continues to take care of us. And he gives us everything we need, not just for our lives here, but also for our lives in heaven. So that's what we get to look forward to, and we're so happy then that Jesus is our shepherd. As he takes care of us in every way that we need. We'll talk more about that in the sermon today. Let's say a prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you for being our good shepherd and for taking care of us in every way. We ask that you would help us to remember that and help us to trust in you and trust that you're going to provide everything that we need for our lives here and that you'll finally bring us to our heavenly home. We pray in your name. Amen. You guys can go down to the tables if you want, or just go back and sit with your families. Continue with our second lesson. It's written in John's first letter, chapter 3, and a pretty short reading, only two verses, but John expresses some pretty important things in those two verses, talking about what great love the Father has for each and every one of us. He's lavished that love on us, and he's shown it by making us his very own children whom he cares for. We read, "See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is." This too is God's word. Our verse of the day, alleluia, alleluia. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Alleluia. Continue with our next hymn. Grace, mercy, and peace be yours from God our Father and from our living Savior, our Good Shepherd, Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, I wonder how many of you, we can take a show of hands here, how many of you do something to secure your home? A few people didn't raise their hands. I'll take note of that. All right. There we go. Yeah, we all take measures to secure our homes, right? Even if it's something just as simple as locking the doors and windows, right? We'll use locks to secure our homes. Will maybe anybody here, anybody have a guard dog? Just real vicious kind of little, you know, thing like this? Maybe. Yeah, some of us might have a dog that helps keep our home secure. Or maybe you've got the full shebang there. You've got the whole alarm system with all the cameras and the sensors and everything, so that if anything moves, you know, those alarms are going off. We do all kinds of things to secure our home. And why? Because we want to be sure that the things that are in that home, and especially the people who are in that home, are going to be safe, right? So we entrust our things and ourselves even to these different modes of security. But finally, isn't it true that no matter what we do, no matter, you know, what kind of system we have in place, there is no 100% foolproof way to secure our home? All of those things can fail, right? We can forget to lock the doors, or the dog could be asleep, or maybe at someone else's house, or those home security systems could run out of juice, or there could be a power outage, or whatever, or false alarms. None of those things is going to give us 100% certainty that nothing bad is ever going to happen to us. Well, today we get a chance to talk a little bit about security and a different kind of security. We entrust ourselves to Jesus. He is our good shepherd, and we're following the theme that it's good to be Jesus' sheep. You see, because Jesus is the only one who, in opposition to all those other things we talked about, he is the only one that can provide 100% foolproof security, giving us the certainty that we will be safe and taken care of for this life and the life to come. So, that's our theme for today. It's good to be Jesus' sheep. And as we consider that, we're going to take a look at Jesus' own words from John chapter 10, where he calls himself the Good Shepherd. Right now, we'll take a look at those words. We're going to read just the first few verses, 11 through 13. So Jesus says, "I am the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he's a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep." So Jesus, he's talking here a bit about shepherding, which maybe, you know, we're familiar a bit with shepherding just because of our coming to church and hearing the stories, right? But in our own society, right, how many of us are really that familiar with shepherding from our society? Not too many, I would guess. Shepherding isn't really done so much the way that it used to be done. Nowadays, if people are raising sheep, probably they've got them in a giant pasture land with the fences all around, and they just graze and they take care of themselves practically. You don't have to worry so much about the wild animals getting at them because, well, they've got the fenced in area, and well, if people spread out as much as they are, there aren't going to be really too many wild animals in any area where there's going to be somebody raising those sheep. But now think for a moment what it would have been like back in Jesus' day, shepherding. Shepherd wakes up in the morning, he opens the pen where he's got all the sheep crammed in there, and he leads them out to go find some pasture. He's got to show them where the food is and where the water is. He's with them all day. He can't leave them because if he does, all kinds of things could happen. Some of the sheep could wander off, get lost. A sheep could go walking and fall into a pit of some kind and hurt itself. Or, yeah, the wild animals that were around, they could come and attack the flock and just devour the sheep as they willed. So the shepherd stayed with them all through the day. And then when night finally came, he led them back and opened up their pen again and got them all safely back inside before closing it and finally turning in for the night. That was the work of the shepherd. Now, maybe some shepherds were well enough off that they hired someone else to do some of that watching for them. But imagine what that would have been like, someone being hired to watch your sheep. I kind of compare it in my mind anyway, a little bit to those kinds of jobs that we had when we were growing up, you know, those first jobs maybe that you had. Anybody here work in like a fast food restaurant or, you know, bussing tables or things like that? You know, those kind of more menial jobs, jobs that no one really enjoys doing so much, right? That's kind of what I think of as being the hired hand for the sheep. I mean, you're there, you're working long hours, it pays lousy, and man, just smells, right? So you can imagine how the hired hand maybe wouldn't enjoy his job so much, but you know, it's a paycheck, so we'll go with it. But especially when troubles come up during the day, you can imagine what the hired hand's gonna do. Yeah, he doesn't care so much about the sheep, so as much as he cares about himself and that he's getting a livelihood from this. And so if something comes to attack those sheep, he's gonna cut and run, right? He's not going to sacrifice himself for these dirty animals. No way. So he runs away. So Jesus, he sets up this comparison, right? The shepherd versus the hired hand, and shows how each of them kind of responds to this relationship with the sheep. And we know that Jesus, he's not really talking here about shepherd and sheep, right? He's talking about people. People and the people who are, who they entrust themselves to, really. So we have to ask ourselves, who are our hired hands? When Jesus is sharing these words, he's talking really specifically about the Pharisees. He's kind of taking them to task because they were supposed to be the shepherds of the people there, and they failed in so many ways, leading them astray, using their powers or their positions of power for their own benefit, not really caring if someone got hurt or lost along the way, no big deal. Jesus confronted them with that. But no Pharisees around here for us today. Who are our hired hands? Who are the ones that we entrust ourselves to? And I think there are a number of things that we can say here. Maybe some people entrust themselves to the government. Maybe some people think, well, the government's there to take care of me. They're there to make sure that my life is okay. And I'm going to trust that they're going to do that. I'm going to trust that they're going to make all the right laws and all the right regulations, so that everyone in this country, and me especially, has a good life. But we know that that's not going to be the case, right? And I'm not speaking against our government by saying that. I'm not trying to be political. Just the fact that our government is full of people. Sinful people. Just like you and me. So the government is never going to be able to do everything that is necessary to provide everything that we need for our lives to make us safe and secure 100% of the time. Okay, so not government. Who else can we entrust ourselves to? Maybe our families, right? If anybody is worthy of our trust and love, it's our families, yeah? I mean, we've made promises to each other to be faithful to each other for as long as we live. We love each other. We do anything for each other, right? And yet we all know, too, from personal experience, you know, that our families haven't always been there for us. They don't always provide for us in just the way that we need. And some of us even experience that in heart-wrenching, life-shattering ways. Family can't do what we need them to do 100% of the time. So to entrust ourselves entirely to our family, strange as maybe it seems, it's not going to work. Because our families are made up of people. Sinful people. Like you and me. Okay, well, pastors, huh? We can entrust ourselves to our pastors, right? I mean, there's the real comparison to Jesus' day with the Pharisees, right? The religious leaders of the day. Surely, I can entrust myself to my pastor. He's going to do everything that I need him to do to make sure that I am 100% safe and secure. Maybe not physically, that's not his job, but spiritually, certainly. And yet, undoubtedly, there have been times when you have felt like your pastor just hasn't quite done everything that you need him to do. And I'll be the first to say, I'm sure that I have probably failed some of you in some ways, not intentionally perhaps, but guess what? I'm a person, a sinful person. And so, yeah, I am going to fail at times. And by the way, I'd like to know if that has happened with any of you. I would really appreciate knowing that so that I could correct it. But the fact is, we can't entrust ourselves entirely even to our pastors because they're sinful people and they're going to fail. They're not going to be able to do everything that we need them to do 100% of the time. So maybe we go through that whole list and we think, okay, there's nobody left, so you know what? Just going to have to do it myself. You know, if you want something to do right, you've got to do it yourself, right? So I'm going to entrust myself to myself. I'm going to take care of myself. I'm going to do everything that needs to be done so that I'm taken care of in this life, so I'm safe and secure, you know, and so that I am spiritually strong too. You know, I don't need anybody else to help me with that. Of course, you see the problem there too, right? Because we're dealing again with people, sinful people, and even you by yourself are going to fail. You know, maybe you make the wrong financial decision and you throw yourself into debt. Maybe you get so fed up with church, you decide, I'm leaving the church and I'm just going to go it on my own. And then what does that lead to? It leads to a lack of love and maybe even a lack of faith. We can't do it on our own either. And so we see how the hired hands act. There's nothing that they can do to give us that 100% certainty of safety and security for here in this life and life hereafter. And then what happens? You know, once those bad times come, we have no support system. And then the wolves come after us, and they devour us. And we've got no foot to stand on. That's why it's good to be Jesus' sheep. Jesus is so much different, so much better than all those hired hands, than anyone or anything we could entrust ourselves to in this world. We entrust ourselves to him. And he tells us why in his next words here. We'll look now at the rest of the text, verses 14 through 18. Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father. So why is Jesus such a good shepherd? And it's important to note that one word there, too, good. I mean, he's not just a shepherd. We noted before, the shepherd, he'll do what he can to take care of the sheep. But you have to wonder, when push comes to shove, how many shepherds are going to be willing to sacrifice themselves for their sheep? How many of them might be just like the hired hand and say, you know, I know these sheep are my livelihood, but this is my life we're talking about. So how many of them would stick around too? But Jesus, he is the good shepherd, the best, the shepherd to the ultimate degree, right? He does it all perfectly. So why is he such a good shepherd? Well, here's one of the things he mentions. He says he knows us just like he knows the Father, and just like the Father knows him. Think about that for a little bit. Jesus knows us just like he knows the Father, and just like the Father knows him. You know, when I read those verses, what came to my mind immediately was this. I think it's something you're all familiar with. You know, a popular diagram to show the relationships between the Trinity, right? Which ultimately is something we can never hope to understand, at least this side of heaven. But you know, the three persons there, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, each one of them is 100% God, and yet they're not each other. And this is used to kind of demonstrate those relationships between the Trinity. And just think about how those persons relate to each other and interact. These perfect beings, God, one essence, perfect being, they relate to each other, love each other more closely, more intimately, more familiarly than anything else in all this creation. They know each other. And Jesus says, this is how I know you. As intimately, as closely, as familiarly as I know my Father and as he knows me. Imagine the comfort in that he knows you that well, that he knows every intimate little thing about you in your whole life, every situation you've ever gone through, every situation you will go through. He is ready with his knowledge and his love to be there for you. Who else would you want to entrust yourself to than someone who knows you that intimately, cares for you that much? What a comfort. So Jesus knows us just as he knows the Father, and the Father knows him. And we get to know Jesus too, he says. And we do that as we listen to his voice. We get to know Jesus better by listening to his voice. Well, how are we going to listen to his voice? We're doing that right now, right? As we gather here for worship, as we hear the word preached and read, as we sing hymns to one another, confess our faith to each other, we encourage each other, we are all Jesus' voice to each other whenever we share that word. And as we study the word at home, as we gather together in groups to study the Bible, either after church here or in our various member homes with our growth groups, all of that is so that we can hear Jesus' voice, so that we can get to know him better and understand more how much he cares for us, how much he loves us, how much he wants to do everything that is necessary for our lives here in this world and our lives hereafter. Who else would you want to entrust yourself to in this life? Jesus is our good shepherd. It's good to be Jesus' sheep. And one more reason that he mentions, he makes the ultimate sacrifice to defend and save us, doesn't he? Maybe a normal shepherd wouldn't do that, but the good shepherd, he did it. He stretched out his arms, he poured out his lifeblood on the cross to wash our sins away. He was willing to go through all that suffering, all the torments, even of hell itself, as God poured out his wrath against him for every sin that we had done. He took it all. He placed himself between the danger and the flock so that he could be your good shepherd. Because of that ultimate sacrifice, we are saved. And yet, that's not the end of it, is it? I mean, what good to us is a dead shepherd? But that's just it, isn't it? As we continue to celebrate Easter, we know our shepherd is not dead. He lives again. And he lives to continue his work as our good shepherd, to continue caring for us and doing everything that is necessary for our lives here and in eternity. That's what a good shepherd does. He lays down his life, but only to take it up again, so that he can continue caring for us, loving us, doing everything that is necessary, and finally, at the end of the day, lead us all back to that sheep pen, our heavenly home, and close the door, so that we are with him for all eternity. It's good to be Jesus' sheep. I mean, looking at that picture, can you imagine yourself, you're the lamb on Jesus' shoulders, right? But now imagine something else in the place of Jesus. how horrible that would be. Whether it's your family or your possessions or your government or even yourself. How awful it would be to be carried only by them. And how blessed it is to be carried by Jesus. You are his little lamb. Amen. Please stand. And the peace of God, which transcends all human understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We'll continue by confessing our faith. We'll use the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated. We continue with the song of the season. At this time, we'll bring our gifts of love to the Lord. Also, would invite you all to sign one of the cards in the backs of the seats in front of you so that we have a record of your attendance. Those cards can be placed either in the offering plate or given to one of the ushers after the service. Thank you. Lord Jesus, our good shepherd, we thank and praise you for all the care that you give to us in our lives. We ask that you would remind us daily of that care, and we bring these gifts to you now that they may be used for that purpose as well. We ask these things in your name. Amen. Please stand for the prayer of the church. God of all grace, we thank you for the gift of eternal life in your Son. By the resurrection of Jesus from the dead, and by the faithful testimony of the apostles, you have assured us that our faith stands on a sure and solid foundation. Though we do not see Jesus with our physical eyes, help us see him with the eyes of faith. Through your Holy Spirit, breathe on your church that it may faithfully proclaim the gospel of our risen Savior with courage and diligence in all lands and to all people. Grant that we may also be illumined by the heavenly light of your word, and so keep us in the one and only true faith. Preserve us from all assaults on our souls. Deliver us from doubt and despair, and preserve us from worldly wisdom and false teaching. Forgive the sins of your people. Strengthen the doubting and faithless. Bring back the forgetful and wayward, and comfort the anxious and the distressed. And we pray especially today for our brother and our pastor, John Ehlers, as he continues his trip back from Detroit. We ask that you would give him a safe trip. We also ask that you would continue to bless him with many more years of life as he today celebrates his 50th birthday. We also give you thanks for all the years that you have given him, and most importantly, that you have given him the gift of faith in you. And hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. As we go from this holy place today, grant peace and rest to us all. We pray this in the name of Christ our Lord, who also taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. I appeal to you, brothers, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree with one another, so that there may be no divisions among you, and that you may be perfectly united in mind and is not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ? And is not the bread that we break a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup.
Thank you.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. He broke it and gave thanks and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. You may be seated. At the direction of the ushers, we invite our members to come forward and those affiliated with our church body to receive the Lord's Supper. Life everlasting. Heart in peace. Your sins are Please stand as we give thanks to our God, singing the words of the Song of Simeon. O God the Father, source of all goodness, in your loving kindness you sent your Son to share our humanity. We thank you that through him you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. We also pray that you will not forsake us, but rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, so that we willingly serve you day after day. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, go in peace. Live in harmony with one another. Serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Please be seated as we close our service with one more hymn, Jerusalem the Golden. What a pleasure and joy it is to be in the house of God with you today and to lead you in worship. Thank you for that opportunity. Again, warm welcome to all our guests and visitors. It's good to have you here with us as well. A couple of quick announcements. I am going to have to leave fairly quickly today after service because I need to get to Vistancia to lead the service over there as well today. So that being said, there will be no Bible class today. and no Sunday school as well because of that. Other announcements, we have a memorial service coming up this next Saturday for Yvonne Janicek, who passed away recently, mother of our member, Kirsten Janicek. So if you're interested in coming to that and offering support to the family, please do so. That's April 28th, Saturday at 10:30 a.m. right here. We also will be having our quarterly voters meeting today a little bit later on, 1 o'clock p.m., so please plan to come back for that so that you can help us guide in the affairs of your church. We also had an announcement from our trustee, our head trustee, Tim Grams, wanted to make an announcement. Okay, thank you. God's blessings on your Sunday and on your week. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. Let's all sing for Pastor Ehlers. Gus is going to record it, and we'll send it off to him as he's on the road. He should like that. Very good. Now, blessings on your Sunday.